Hi everyone, good morning or good evening. Shall we start?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, guys. So today we will see how the read and write operation to the Hadoop file system, which is a distributed file system, will be done. Okay, so some core components, like some core concepts around this HDFS read and write operations, we will see how it was designed. Okay, so before I start, right, we need to, I will talk some brief history about how Hadoop was developed. Okay. Actually, the architecture of the Hadoop was taken from Google itself. Okay. Even before Hadoop was developed, Google has developed something called as a Google file system. The so-called Hadoop file system is based on the Google file system. And the way the data was stored on Google file system, Google developed a different approach to process the data. Okay. And that approach is called as a MapReduce. Okay. So what happened is during early 2003 and 2004, okay, at the time Google has called for a summit and they announced that they're indexing the huge volume of data, okay, and they're using a distributed storage system and they're using a distributed computing framework. Then the developer of the Hadoop was also part of that summit. He attended summit and he asked the Google people to publish white papers. Okay, then the Google white papers were published. White paper means like it's some technical document, like how they designed the distributed file system, how they designed the like a program computing framework to process the data that is stored on that distributed system. They released white papers. Even today they are available. If you go and search for the internet, in the internet, right, you can get them. Okay, so you can say Google white paper on GFS, Google file system, something like that. Okay, say the Google file system. You can say this was in early 2003. Okay, so you can read it and you can understand, right? And similarly, they have developed, so they have released another white paper, Google white paper on MapReduce. So for a distributed computing system, right? So how you have to process the data that is stored on this one. So MapReduce, simplified data processing on a large cluster. See, this was released by Google. Again, this will be in the year of 2004 or something. Okay. A person called Doc Cuttings, okay, who attended this Google summit. Okay, he to understand this Google file system and Google MapReduce. Okay, he thought of developing some open source framework, okay, which can be used to index huge volume of data. Basically, want to create some search engine kind of thing. Okay, so with that intention, he started writing the code, and eventually, okay, he developed it and like I mentioned, right, he want to open source it. So he open sourced. So when you say open source, there are some open source communities or foundations are there. So among those open source foundations, Apache is one of the largest open source foundation we have. So all this code and all went to Apache. Okay, so now we can say Apache Hadoop. That's what it's called as an Apache Hadoop. Now, this is one of the best thing that the dog cutting has did, open sourcing this Apache Hadoop. Since he open sourced this Apache Hadoop, right? So Apache Hadoop has this people has taken that it has become an incubator project. It has become a like a pilot project, like a long term project. Many people started contributing, and the first release of Hadoop has happened. I think during some year 2007 or something, and they come like the production with the 1.x version or something came somewhere in 2008 or 9 like that. Since that, many people started contributing to the Hadoop. Over a period of time, so many ecosystem tools were developed on top of Hadoop. If you look at the Hadoop, like I showed, Hadoop has these modules: Hadoop Common, the common utilities that support the other modules, Hadoop Distributed File System, a distributed file system that provides high throughput access to the application data, and Hadoop Yarn, a framework for job scheduling and a cluster resource management, like resource manager, and Hadoop MapReduce, a Yarn-based system for parallel processing of the large data sets. So these are the main modules of the Hadoop. On top of this Hadoop, other things were developed, like Ambari. Ambari is a web-based tool for provisioning, managing, and monitoring the Apache Hadoop clusters, which includes the support for Hadoop HDFS, Hadoop MapReduce, Hive, Hcatalog, HBase, Zookeeper, UG, Pig, Scoop, all this kind of stuff. These are like a ecosystem tools that were built on top of Hadoop. I will tell why they are called as ecosystem tools, all those stuff. Then this Ambari also provides a dashboard for viewing the cluster health, such as heat maps and ability to view MapReduce, Pig, and Hive application visually, along with the features to diagnose their performance characteristics in a user-friendly manner. So like, we need a cluster management for the administrative purpose. We want to monitor the health of the cluster. So for that, this Ambari will be used. Just a minute. Hello. Mahesh class lo na Mahesh. Malli maatladde ankoku. Enante text WhatsApp. Sorry guys. So there are so many tools that were developed on top of Apache Hadoop. Like we have Avro, Cassandra, Chukwa, HBase, Hive, Mahout, UG, Pig, Spark, even like Spark was developed as an extension to the Hadoop, right? Then Submarine, I didn't heard of this, Tej, another computing framework like Yarn, Zookeeper, all this stuff, So here, Apache Hadoop means it is a open source tool. So now how this distributed file system was developed. So the Hadoop distributed file system was developed based on the Google file system, based on the idea, based on the architecture, or based on the technical thoughts of the Google file system. But what is the difference between a Google file system and HDFS? What is the difference between Google MapReduce and Hadoop MapReduce? Simple. The Google file system and Google MapReduce are proprietary to the Google. That means they're not open source. But Hadoop HDFS and Hadoop MapReduce, they are open source. So whoever want to, we can get the source code, and we can get the, you can easily get the source code, and you can easily get the binaries of that Hadoop also. Or simply, if you go here and search, right? Okay, you can say, if you go to downloads, from here you can directly search the Hadoop source code or Hadoop binaries. You can download the source code, and you want to make any changes, like you want to improvise that, you want to add some features, you are feel free to add. Once you tested everything, we can submit the code back, and there will be some community people, some people will be contributing to this development, right? They can review that, and they can add the features whatever you developed, right, to the Hadoop packages also. We can perform like that. So it is like a open source thing. We can get both the source code, and we can get the binaries also. Okay, if you see, the latest version of Hadoop is a 3.3.1, which was released in 2021 June 15th last year. Okay, and here you can see what are the major changes they did in the release notes. Okay, so this is about the like Apache Software Foundation, Hadoop as open source, and other stuff. Now, like why the name Hadoop has given to this? So generally, these and all will not come as interview questions, but just an interesting thing, right? The developer of the Hadoop dog cutting, when he want to release this code, he want to give some name to this framework, right? And his intention was to give a name which should be not a noun, and a name that does not exist in the internet. That means people should not know about that name. You want to choose such a kind of word. And he has a son who was playing with a baby elephant, and his son used to call that baby elephant as a Hadoop. So that's why he took this name Hadoop from his son, who is calling the toy baby elephant as a Hadoop. So he has taken that and given the name as a Hadoop. And the symbol also they have given like an elephant. Like many of the open source software, if you see, right, people will be using some animal name, some animal symbol or animal name, right? So that's how the name of the Hadoop has been given. And again, it was apt, like some people easily connected. When you say big data, and when you say Hadoop for big data, and this Hadoop was represented by elephant, right? So people will be thinking like, okay, it's like a elephant is a big animal, right? So it represents a big data like kind of thing. So all these are some coincidences, and some of these that were happening. Okay, so leaving all these history apart, okay, so now get into the internals of the Hadoop file system. Okay, now here, whenever you want to have a distributed computing systems, right, like we are talking about a cluster, a group of systems, right, Hadoop is developed in such a way that we can create the Hadoop cluster with the commodity hardware. Okay, we can create the Hadoop cluster with the commodity hardware. So when I say commodity hardware, it's not a cheap hardware. It is like some low end kind of an hardware kind of thing. When you take hardware, there can be some enterprise level hardware. So in this, there will be some commonly used hardware. Commodity hardware is commonly used hardware kind of thing. Okay. So the enterprise level hardware have some sophisticated features like automatic data backup or some failure handling, some sort of this, right? Maybe the commodity hardware may not have some features to handle the things at a hardware level failures. Okay, so one of the advantages with Hadoop is we can set up the Hadoop with the commodity hardware itself. So we no need to go for supercomputers, okay, or big enterprise level servers. Okay, and again, in most of the real time, what we'll be using is we'll be using something like a rack servers. So when you go with a, like in a real-time environment, your Hadoop cluster will be configured as a multiple racks. Okay, if you see here, each red line, okay, each red line can be like a one rack. Within a one rack, there can be multiple systems will be there. These are called as a rack servers. Rack servers. Okay, so this rack servers, like you can think, it looks like a shelf kind of a thing, right? So within that shelf, right? Okay, you can just imagine. So there will like a multiple servers will be there. Okay, so here you can see, right? So this is how a rack server looks like, exactly like this. You can see, right? Each one, this one is one server, this one is one server, this one is one server, this one is one server. It will be like this. Again, in rack server, there will be two types, a blade server and a non-blade server. And for Hadoop cluster, to set up Hadoop clusters, we'll not be using a blade server, we'll be using a rack servers. Okay, and all these racks will not be in the same place. Okay, so this rack one can be building one. Okay, in, let's say I'm from TCS company, and my TCS company there in Whitefield and Electron City and my Mysore, or say Manyata Tech Park, somewhere like that. Right now, rack one can be in building one, rack two can be in the same building in a different floor, and rack three can be in another location, and rack four can be in another location. So they have these racks in different places. So this is for the failure and backup strategies to handle this. See, whenever some problem with one lab, right? So the servers in the rack will not be available. So when the servers in this rack are available, so what we can do? So, you know, like we have discussed, right? There is a replication of the data, or we can fail, we can switch out another name node under, we can still access this data from the cluster. Rather than a complete failure, it makes like a partial failure. Okay, so the things will not be halted. Things may get slowed down, but they will not be halted. So in a real-time environment, okay, so the Hadoop clusters will be set up using a rack systems, a rack servers, we can call them. Okay. And again, so what is HDFS good for? Like I mentioned, right? The HDFS is good for storing large files, like a terabytes in size or petabytes or GBs in size. Okay. We can have millions rather than billions of files. And we can have the files at least 100 MB or more per file. Okay, so generally there is a something called as a block size. We'll discuss on that block size in a couple of minutes. Okay, so it's better to store the large files on the HDFS. Why? Means if you store a small files, okay, like a more number of small blocks will be created, and eventually our name node metadata increases. When the name node metadata increases, okay, sometimes when you want to access the HDFS, it may, the performance may come down. It may not come down drastically, but the latency may increase. Okay, so streaming data. So we can write once and read many times. So the HDFS will follow a pattern of write once and read, write once and read many times. We'll be writing the data to the HDFS only once, but we can read it many times. It is optimized for streaming reads rather than random reads. Random read means, like I mentioned, right? Whenever you have a file, if you open a file, the file pointer will be pointing to the very first line in that file. And when you want to process the file, we will be processing the file reading line by line. If it is a small line, we can get the content of the whole file into a one list or array. But even then, it will be, we'll be reading the file line by line only. Okay, so we cannot randomly read the data. The same thing here. Okay, the Hadoop, the whatever the data that is stored on the HDFS, okay, it is optimized to stream reads rather than the random reads. That means if I want to directly read a 20th line of a file, we cannot read it the 20th line of a file. The reason being because the files are divided as a blocks, because HDFS is a block structured file system. Okay, and once we write the data, return the data to the HDFS, we cannot modify the data. Once we have returned the data to the HDFS, we cannot modify the data within the same file. At most, what we can do is we can append the data to the files written to the HDFS. Appending means adding the data at the end. So the append operation is supported, whereas write, like a random read write access to the files, are not supported to the data that is stored on the HDFS. Okay, so once the data is written to the HDFS, we cannot modify the data. At least we can append the data to the file. So if we want to modify the data, what we need to do is we need to transform the data. That means you have to read the existing data, then you have to transform it and create another copy of that data. Okay, so the way the HDFS is architecture, we can write the data once and read as many times we want. Once the data is written to the HDFS, we cannot modify it because the data will be written as a multiple blocks. After writing a datum, I cannot randomly go to a particular number, like a particular line number, and make the changes. Okay, that is how HDFS is different. Okay, so when you want to set up the Hadoop cluster, like I mentioned, right, we no need to go for the supercomputers. Okay, we can use less reliable commodity hardware. Now the commodity hardware is cost effective, okay, compared to the supercomputers. Next one. So what HDFS is not good for? We have seen HDFS is good for storing large data, write once, read many times. Like we can have a parallel reading of the data, all these things. But there are some downside of this HDFS also. So low latency reads, high throughput rather than low latency for small chunks of data, right? That means throughput means like how fastly you can read and write that data, right? So the HDFS write operation is a serial write process. It is slow, whereas reading is fast only. Again, whenever you want to read some data on the HDFS, always the request has to go through the name node only. So that's why sometimes it may be a little slow while reading the data from the HDFS. Okay, because you have to, client has to connect to the name node. Name node has to fetch the details, it has to give the details, and again your client has to go to that, talk to the individual data nodes directly and get those blocks. So it may be slightly slow. Okay, and it is meant for large amount of it's a large amount of small files. Okay, so like I mentioned, that whenever you're writing a file to the HDFS, it will divide into a small blocks and it will be written. So like when you have a bigger files, okay, so all of them will be, like any file will be cut down into a blocks and it will be written. HDFS is good to store a reasonable number of large files rather than storing a small files. Okay, so the block size of HDFS can be 64 MB or 128 MB or multiples of 64 MB. Okay, so daily you are getting a data less than like a 64 MB, like and we are getting a small files will end up in having more volume of metadata. So in that cases, what we can do, right? So we can combine the data as a single large file and write it and erase the small files so that we can do it. Okay, and multiple write operators. So we cannot write the data multiple, it's a single write per file. Writes only at the end of the file, no support for the arbitrary offset. Like I mentioned, that once you've written a file to the HDFS, randomly we cannot go to a particular line and modify or write something there. At most, we can write the data at the end of the file. So that is append operation is only supported. Right? Now for this HDFS to work, right, there will be some services that are required. So these services, okay, they will be called as a daemons. So this is another terminology that's in Unix kind of a system. The background processes or the long running background processes are called as a daemons. Okay. Now, what are the services or the daemons that are required for the HDFS to run? So we need a name node, which is a management node, and we need a secondary name node, which is also like a another management node, and we need a data nodes. So if you take a cluster, right, a cluster of systems, like I mentioned, in one of the system we'll be starting a name node service. In another system, we'll be starting a secondary name node service. In other systems, we'll be starting a data node services. These data node services, okay, they will work like a workers, and the name node will work like a management node or manager node. And if you see, the secondary name node is talking to only the name node. You can see the link here. Because the purpose of secondary name node is connect to the name node regular intervals of time and take the backup or create a snapshot of the name node metadata. And you can see all these data nodes, they are connected to the name node. So they will be sending their heartbeat signals, block report information, all those stuff. Okay. So these entities are required for your HDFS to work properly. So whenever we say, we are starting the Hadoop cluster, first name node will be started. Then you can start the data nodes. Then you can start the secondary name nodes. Okay. Now, how the data will be written to the HDFS? Like I mentioned already. So for the end user, the HDFS looks like a single file system or a single disk. Okay, but whereas the HDFS is sitting on top of the multiple disks of the multiple data nodes. Okay, now when I have a file like some hamlet.txt file here, some example that again, if I have some file, this file, okay, will be cut down into multiple blocks. Let's say block one, block two, okay, like that. And these blocks will be return to the your data nodes. And again, when you're writing a one block, okay, one block will be minimum three copies of that block will be written. And the copies of the same block will not be written to the same node. So the purpose of writing the blocks to the different nodes is in the incident like one system gone down, we should not lose that block of data. That's why the B1 will not be written to the same system. Let's say we call this as a nodes, node 1, node 2, node 3, node 4, like that. So the B1 is written to node 1, node 3, and node 10, something like that. So the data will be chopped down as a multiple block, and it will be written to the multiple nodes in the cluster. Again, there is a something called as a block placement algorithm. So HDFS internally follow something called as a block placement algorithm. In that block placement algorithm, what it will write, one copy of a block will be written to one node in one server, one rack. The other two copies of the same block will be written to the two different nodes within another rack. Okay, so that is a block placement algorithm. Okay, so whatever the one copy of the block will be written to a one node in one rack. Okay, another remaining two copies of the same block will be written to a two different data nodes within the another rack. So this is called as a block placement algorithm. Again, we cannot decide on to choose which data node to store which block of data, right? Whenever we are writing a data through Hadoop FS commands or programmatically, the request will go to the name node, and name node will give the set of data nodes. and the client will cut down this file into block, and the client will write the blocks of data to those nodes. So which nodes the data will be written will be decided by the name node and the client. So we don't have a choice to select them. And again, we no need to choose also. It's not required. Okay. So this is how the data will be written. Okay. So here today we heard something like a block placement algorithm. So block placement algorithm, what it says, like if you take the default replication factor of HDFS, it is a 3. Okay. Now when you're writing a file, the file will be divided into multiple blocks, and each block will be replicated 2 times. That means original block and 2 copies, let's say total there will be 3 copies of the block. One copy of the block will be written to a one node in one rack. The remaining 2 copies of the same block will be written to 2 different nodes in the another rack. Okay, so now this is to handle the failovers, right? If the single data node goes down, still we are able to access the data from the other data nodes. If the entire rack goes down, still we'll be able to access the data, because that data is it was written to the data nodes in the rack level. So we are trying to go with some probability. What is the probability that a single server is going down? What is the probability that a single rack is going down? So that's why they follow a block placement algorithm, where one copy of block will be written to a one node in one rack, another 2 copies of the block will be written to the 2 different data nodes in the another rack. So that is a block placement algorithm. Next, okay. Here, so what are these block replications? The name node determines the replica placement. The replica placements are rack aware. So we can call the Hadoop framework as a rack. It has a rack awareness. Rack awareness means within this Hadoop cluster, how many racks are there? All these are like a bit of admin concepts. We no need to bother, but try to understand. Because see, not only when you're learning a new framework, not only how to use that framework, how to code that pro, how to store the data, how to process that is important. We should know as much as possible some of the internals, okay, some of the basics. So that's why we're spending this much time. Okay, so the name node here determines the replica placement. Like I mentioned, we don't have the choice where you can place the replicas of the blocks. The name node will determine them. Okay. These replica placements are rack aware. So like I mentioned, right, one copy of the block will be written to a one node in one rack, another copies of the same block will be written to another nodes in another rack. Okay, so this makes the balance between the reliability and the performance. This will attempts to reduce the bandwidth. It will attempts to improve the reliability by putting replicas on the multiple racks. Okay, and the default replication is 3. The first replica will be on the local rack, wherever your client node is there, and the second replica on the local rack, but a different machine, and the third replica is on the different rack. So it will make a policy that one replica will be written on the local rack, second replica on the local rack, but a different machine, and the third replica on the altogether different rack itself. So this is a block placement algorithm, and this policy may change or improve in the future also, because now I think in the Hadoop 3.x version, the HDFS was slightly changed. The underlying the HDFS was changed, but none of the HDFS commands are changed. We don't need to bother about that. So for us, we can consider that HDFS as a black box and a MapReduce as a black box. We just want to know how we can interact with them by using some Hadoop shell commands or by using some APIs kind of stuff. Okay, so next, how we can perform the write operation, the Hadoop file write operation, right? So here what happens, right? So we perform a write operation, how we can do that. Let's say I have shown you, right? I have some file, okay, something like a sales.csv file. Let me put some name, sales2020.csv file. This file is there on my local system. Let's say I got it from some remote FTP server or from production database server, someplace it was there. Okay, so let's say it was there in a prod FTP server. So some FTP server was there. In that FTP server, let's say they have given slash, again, data slash exports slash my team and some my team name, something, or my project. So for example, assume that whoever the production database people, they created the sales2020.csv file and they kept in this FTP server location. Now what we need to do, we need to get this file to our client node. So we'll get this file to the client node. So how we can do? So from this client node, we'll be connecting to that FTP server using FTP commands. We can transfer them. FTP means file transfer protocol. There are some tools will be there, or commands will be there. Using those commands, we can fetch the data. But to connect to this, we should know the user ID and password. That will be known. So we'll connect to this one. And let's say we got the file. And here I put my file into slash temp slash data. Okay. And here I have my file. Let's say like this. So this is on the client node or my edge node. Okay, this slash temp slash data, this one. Sorry. So this location where this file is there, let's say I'll call this as a LFS, my local file system. It is on the hard disk portion where my local files will be stored on the client node. Now I want to write this data to the HDFS, okay, to a location called slash, okay, let's say my project slash data, say sales, okay, sales data, something like that. Under this one, I want to write the sales2020.cs. So this is under HDFS where we want to write the data. How we can write the data? We can from the client node. Okay. So from the terminal, from the client node terminal, I can say. Terminal. We'll write a command. In the client node terminal, so Hadoop is installed. The Hadoop binaries will be there. Right? From the client node terminal, I give a command like Hadoop. FS, okay, hyphen, let's say copy from local, okay, so then I give this location, okay, I have given this location, then this is my source and this is my destination. So my destination, I want this on HDFS, this location. So this is a command I will be using on the client node terminal. Hadoop fs minus copy from local, or Hadoop fs minus put, or instead of Hadoop fs we can use HDFS also. So Hadoop fs minus copy from local, this source file on the local file system, and the path where it has to be done, the HDFS. Right? As soon as I run this command, what will happen? We will see now. Whenever we run this command, so on the client system, we have writing that, we have issued that command, right? The request will first go to the name node. Okay, so the request will first go to the name node. So create a file in the name node's namespace, calculate the block topology. right? So the client system will send some details of the file. So this is the size of the file, this is a file I want to run, this is a location I want to write, and these information will go to the name node, and the name node will calculate okay approximately how many blocks it can get, okay? And the name node will acknowledge the client node with some set of data nodes. Okay, so the name node will tell to the client, you can use a data node 1, data node 2, data node 5, data node 8, data node 10, okay, data node 22, data node 34, something like, because based on the space that is available on the data nodes, because name node will be monitoring them, whichever data nodes have a more free space, like it can identify and give to the client. Now what the client will do, the client will cut down that file into small blocks, and on what basis that file will be cut down into small blocks means there is something called as a block size, HDFS block size. Okay, so if you take in Hadoop 1.x, the HDFS block size is by default 64 MB. In Hadoop 2.x onwards, the default HDFS block size is 128 MB. Okay, we can have a block size set to any number, but it should be a multiple of 64 MB. Your block size should be a multiple of 64 MB. So the default block size in Hadoop 1.x is 64 MB, and the default block size in Hadoop 2.x onwards is 128 MB. If you want to decrease or you want to increase, we can increase the block size, but ideally it should be a multiplication factor on the 64 MB. It is on the multiples of 64 MB. Okay, why it should be 64 MB or multiples of 64 MB, we'll say little later. Now the client program will cut down the file into small blocks, and the client will write those blocks to the node. The client will write only one block of data. Okay, let's say the client has written this one block to a node 10, and it will, node 10 will be instructed, okay, to copy that block and send it to the node 12, right? So the replication will happen. Now the node 12 will be informed to make a copy of that block and send it to the node 24. That means your client is writing only one block. That means your client is writing only, if you're taking 1 GB of data, it is only writing the 1 GB of 1 GB volume of data only. But the replicas will be handled by the data nodes. So replicas happens across the data nodes. Okay. Now this data node will make a copy of this block and it will send it to the another data node. And this data node will make a copy of this block and send it to the another data node, right? Now once the block is written, the last data node which has received the third copy of that block, it will send an acknowledgement to the previous data node from where it got the request, and this previous data node will send a request to the first data node where the client has written the first block. It will send an acknowledgement, and once the acknowledgement is received from the data node where the client has written the original first block of data, the client will get a confirmation that the first block of data is written. Then what the client will do, it will start writing the next block. Again, that next block has to be replicated. Again, the acknowledgements has to go back and forth. And once the second block is successfully written, then the client will start writing the third block. And once the third block is written and replicated, then it will write the fourth block. And once the fourth block is written and replicated, then it will go with the fifth block. So like that. So that we are writing the data block by block. So it is a sequential write operation, not a parallel write operation. We don't parallel take the multiple blocks and parallel write to the data nodes. That's why the Hadoop write operation is a little slow. It is a sequential write operation. Okay, So here the client node, what it will do, if it is in the number two, it will stream data to the first node. That means it will write the data to the one node, right? And the data node which has reached the first block, what it will do, right? It will stream the data to the second node in the pipeline. Then the second data node will stream the data to the third node, and a successful acknowledgement will come from the third node to the second node to the first node, and the acknowledgement finally reaches the client, and the client will assume, like, will get a confirmation the first block of data is successfully returned. Then the same process repeats with the another blocks of data. Okay, so this is how the a name node write operation will happen. Sorry, the write operation to the HDFC will happen. Now, after writing all the blocks, what this client will do, right? The client will know, right? So this is the first block. This is a first block ID, and where and all this first blocks was written, and where and all it is replicated, and what is the checksum on this file, and when was they were written. All this information for each block the client will has. Once the file is successfully written, the client will send this metadata of these blocks, that means the information of these blocks, to the edit log. The client will send the information about all the blocks of the file where they are written and replicated to the edit log. Now, once the data goes written to the edit log, what happens? Okay, the information from the edit log, the data what we written to the edit log, will be automatically copied to the RAM of the name node where the metadata is already residing. So the name node will get aware that, okay, for this file, it has written in so-so location. These are the number of blocks. These are the distribution of the blocks. All this information the name node has. Now, whoever wants to read that file, okay, if you know the location of the file, now if you want to read the file, or let's say if you want to get this file, so what I can do, I can write a command like this. So this I can say like a write command. Okay, now say I want to read or get my file locally, right? Now I can say Hadoop fs minus get, or we can use hype copy to local something. Okay, let's say I use this one so that it will be easy for you. Copy to local. Okay, now what I will do, I will give this HDFS location. Only thing is, you need to remember this, your HDFS path, at least the root directory of the HDFS path you have to remember. Then we can use Hadoop fs, and step by step we can go inside the block subfolders also, right? So once you know the HDFS path, you can say Hadoop fs minus copy to local HDFS path on the local path, let's say slash temp. Okay slash temp and test, something like this. Now this file from this HDFS location, it will be copied to the your local file, local path, slash temp slash test underscore data is a local path. Now these sales underscore 2020, let's say it have some 50 blocks. Now when the file, when you get the file here, okay, you will get the file as a single file only. So 50 blocks you are going to get as a single file. How you are going to get that? So whenever we run this command, what will happen, right? The request will go to the name node, and the name node has the metadata of this file. So for this sales underscore 2020.csv file, okay, these are the number of blocks, and these blocks are available on so and so data nodes, right? This information the name node will fetches from its RAM, and it will give to the client. Now what the client will do, right? Client will directly connect to the data nodes and read those blocks of data, right? And the client will read those blocks of data. Okay, so this is how the read operation will happen. So the client will send a request to the name node. With the help of name node, the client will retrieve the block locations. Now the client will directly connect to the data node, read blocks to reassemble the file. Okay, we have reassembled the file, which was divided as multiple blocks, right? We have to collect all those blocks and have to arrange them in the order. So randomly, we should not put a block 1, block 5, block 2, block 10, block 3, block 4, like that. It should block 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. In the order, you have to reassemble, right? So the client will get these blocks location details from the name node, since the name node maintains the metadata, and it will directly connect to the data nodes, and it will read those individual blocks of data and arranges those blocks in the starting order, block 1, 2, 3, 4, and it will write the data to the local system if you are using the command which I showed there. Okay, so whenever client is reading the data, look here, it can parallelly connect to the data nodes and get these blocks. The client will not read the data sequentially. When I say sequentially, like a sequential block, the client will not read the first block first, second block second, third block third, fourth block fourth, one by one. What it will read, it parallelly or simultaneously connect to the all the data nodes wherever the blocks are available and read that block from that data nodes parallelly. Once it has read connected to this data nodes, read these blocks parallelly, then it will arrange them, reassemble them, sort them, and write as a single file to the your local file system. So the HDFS read operation is parallel, whereas HDFS write operation is sequential. The HDFS write operation is sequential. Okay, so this is how the read and write operations will be performed to the HDFS. Okay. Now, like I have another material also, which will beautifully explains all these concepts, okay, with the diagrams. I can share you that, so you can go through that one. Okay, maybe today I will share that in our WhatsApp. I will share that one. Okay. Currently, I'm not getting where I have put that file, but I will share with you soon today after the class. Okay. Any doubts so far? Are we good so far?
You said the read operation is parallel, right? So yeah. If it wants to stitch a block one, you know, then block two, then block three, will that do, or it will be like, you know?
It's not required, right? See, whenever the purpose of going for the distributed computing is, like parallelly you want to read the data and parallelly apply the tasks. Okay, so like the requirement to read the block sequentially will be, at least I didn't encounter them in the real time.
Okay.
Yeah, the purpose is like, see, one person is doing a job. Now we are using 20 people to do the same job. So obviously the same job has to divide into small tasks, and you have to give those tasks to the individual people. And of course, the output given by the each person, again, we need to consolidate and make it as a final work. So that's why in the map reduce, we have two phases, map phase and the reduce phase. In the map phase, the individual, like a mapping work will be done, like a select statement. And in the reduce phase, group by and aggregations will be done. Okay, so now when you're doing the one-to-one transformations are mapping the data like what are required, we no need to require to read the data sequentially. We can take the individual blocks of data and we can perform that operation.
Right. Yeah, you make sense. Yeah.
Okay, like so when you come to the map reduction, you will get a even better clarity. Okay. Yeah. So now, some of the concerns from the name node memory we'll understand. Okay, for fast access of name node keeps all blocks metadata in memory. Okay, so if you see right in the first class or demo class or second class I mentioned, when you are writing the data to your hard disk, your operating system will maintain a file tables. It will write this data to even separate files, and this file table content the operating system will load into RAM. Okay, if you shut down the system, your RAM contents will be gone because the RAM is a volatile thing. But once you shut down and again restart the system, when you want to read back the file which you have written to the hard disk before shutdown, after restarting system, still you are able to read it. How it is possible means, okay, whatever the file that was written to the hard disk, that information will be stored in a separate file. And when you're restarting the system, that file will be loaded into the memory. That's why your operating system will take some time to reboot, right? So when you're restarting the system, right, it will load this file table contents into the memory. Okay, along with that, some other services also needs to be started. That's why it will take some time, boot up time. Okay, same thing happens with the name node also. In order to access the blocks information of the files that are stored on the HDFS fastly, the RAM, the name node will keeps this blocks information, nothing but metadata in memory, nothing but RAM. Okay, so the bigger cluster, the more RAM is required. That means you have a very big cluster, we tend to store more data on the big cluster, then we have a more amount of RAM. Okay, so best for millions of large files, 100 MB or more, rather than the billions. Okay, will work well for the clusters of hundreds of machines. So like I mentioned, right, so we can store huge number of files on the HDFS, but it's better to store more number of larger files or lesser number of larger files rather than larger number of small files. Okay, if you write a larger number of small files, okay, each small file becomes like a small block, it will increase the amount of the name node metadata. And since this data has to be there in the RAM, the name node requires more RAM to be available. Okay, so we need to keep in mind. So rather than writing a small files to the HDFS, better to have the bigger files written to the HDFS, right? In the name node 2, there are some improvements were made to the name node, something called as a name node federation. So with the name node federation, at least I have not seen this name node federation being used. This makes the administrative work complex. Here what happens with the name node federation, so federation means multiple group of people kind of thing, right? So when I say name node federation, we can have the multiple name nodes to the cluster, and each name node will host part of the blocks. Okay, and these name nodes are horizontally scalable, and this supports 1000 plus machines of cluster. Okay, so Yahoo was running 50,000 plus machines as a single Hadoop cluster. Okay, but there are some challenges with the name node federation, all those things. So nowadays we are not using that much. So but what we'll be using is a name node high availability we'll be using, that we'll discuss a later part of this course. Okay, so this is the one concern regarding to the name node memory. So in general, in a real-time environment, whenever we are taking a name node, we'll try to have a more RAM in the name node, right? Wherever we are studying the name node services in the system, we'll try to keep more RAM compared to another systems. And of course, your secondary name node also should have the more or less identical same amount of RAM, because whatever the checkpointing, that the snapshotting will be done by the secondary name node, right? Taking the latest edit log and taking the previous image, FS image, merging them and creating a new FS image. All these activities will happen in the memory. So that's why name node and secondary name node, it's good to have a more RAM compared to the other nodes in the Hadoop cluster. Okay. And the name node daemon process must be running at all the times. If the process crashes, then the cluster is down. So your name node is the single point of failure for your Hadoop cluster. Let's say among all the services, name node, secondary name node, data node, resource manager, node manager, all these are running. If the name node goes down, your cluster is useless. The reason being, you have stored the data in a distributed manner. Since name node is down, we don't know the metadata, where this data is stored for each file. Since we don't have that information, we cannot perform a read access, we cannot perform a write access to the HDFS, and same way, we cannot process any of the data on the HDFS because we don't have the information about the blocks. So name node is a single point of failure. Okay, so now how we can make a name node, how we can come across this single point of failure of the name node. So from the Hadoop 2.x onwards, what they did, right? So they introduced something called as an high availability name node. High availability name node. Like I mentioned, there will be two name node services that will be running. One name node service on one system, another name node service on another system. But at any given point of time, only one name node will be active. Another name node will be passive. And these two name nodes will be sending their heartbeat signals to another entity called as ZooKeeper. Okay, we'll talk about ZooKeeper later, but as of now, you remember, a ZooKeeper works as a resource coordinator. So the name node 1 and the name node 2 both will be sending their heartbeat signals, that means their liveliness signals, to the ZooKeeper. Now let's say after some time the ZooKeeper not getting heartbeat signals from the name node 1, which is an active name node, then the ZooKeeper will think there is some potential problem with the name node 1. Let me make the name node 2 as the active name node. Now the ZooKeeper will send a signals to, it will notify or send a signals to the name node 2 to become active. So that again is the admin part, we no need to bother about that, but it will automatically happen, right? I can mention it, we're handling the failures at a software level. When a software level, within the framework we're handling, the Hadoop framework will handle this failures. So in the Hadoop 1.x, the name node is a single point of failure. That's why many companies hesitant to work with the Hadoop, like particularly the financial companies, like banking sector companies or financial companies, right? So after understanding the architecture of the Hadoop, they tell, okay guys, you are telling if the name node goes down, so we cannot access the data. So what if you are running some real-time report generation like we are running some production jobs and all, if the name node goes down, that means we don't have an automatic failure, so our all jobs will be halted, and that will affect our data pipelines, all those stuff. Okay, we don't go with the Hadoop. So that's what many people step back using Hadoop. But later on, very soon, when Hadoop 2.x was released, right, people came with the high availability concept. Now with the high availability concepts, there can be slightly very less amount of downtime can be there. That means your cluster may not be, we are not to perform the read write operation, but the switchover can happen. The switchover can happen from the passive name node, sorry, active name node to the passive name node, or the passive name node to become the active. So that internally they use some network proxies and ZooKeeper notifications, blah, blah, blah. They can handle that. So there will be configurations available. So you can say, so HDFS high availability that HTML. So if you go to this one, so they would have clearly given how that high availability configurations can be done. And again, at a data engine level, we no need to bother. We just know the some concepts, the implementation, but the Hadoop administrators will be knowing. So the high availability name node, what do you mean? There will be an active standby is always running and takes over in case of main name node fails. Okay, so many of the companies who are using Hadoop nowadays, they're using the Hadoop 2.x or more versions, and they have high availability name node configuration setup. Okay, so these are the two things we need to keep in mind with respect to the name node. So one is the requirement of the more RAM for the name node and failure of the name node. Okay, so during some points, right, like in the early days of Hadoop interview, right, so there were some questions around this. So what is the single point of failure for the Hadoop cluster? So whenever your name node goes down, so how you're going to handle this, right? So these were some of the questions that people used to ask for the data engineers also. So even the interview knows they are not a Hadoop administrators, but still they used to ask these questions. So just to know, like, how much people understand the architecture of the Hadoop. So that's what they used to ask these questions. Okay, so now how we can access the HDFS, right? So far I have shown you, we can, if you want to interact with the Hadoop file system, okay, we can interact with the Hadoop FS commands. So this is like a command, right? So this is like a, just like a command. But if you look at Hadoop as a framework, if you take, right, it was completely written in Java. So if you look Hadoop as a framework, internally has two things, right? One is the HDFS framework. You can consider HDFS as a one framework. Okay, as such, so this is also written in Java, right? Now another one is a MapReduce part, right? You can take MapReduce as another framework, right? So this is also written in Java. Okay. So your HDFS is written in Java. In order to access HDFS, the Hadoop framework has provided an APIs. So Hadoop provided APIs to interact with HDFS. Interact with HDFS means to perform, okay, to perform read-write access. To perform read and write operations. Okay, like creating a directory, deleting a directory, writing a file, appending to a file, or removing the files, or replicating the blocks. All these things, right? Or get to know the size of the files, that you want to know the access controls on the files, all these things, right? To perform all these things, okay, they provide an APIs. But imagine, always you need to write a code, right? Always if it is required to write a code to read the data, write the data, delete a directory, create a directory, it becomes hectic. Okay, all the people may not be comfortable with the Java. And again, Java is not like a simply interpreted language. First, it has to be compiled, then only you have to execute it. Right? So what the Hadoop developers have done, right? So they introduced some simple shell commands. So they introduced Hadoop shell they provided to ease our work. So to ease our work interacting with the HDFS, Hadoop provided Hadoop shell commands. So Hadoop shell commands, okay, were provided, okay, to ease our efforts, okay, to interact with HDFS. Okay, again, this is like I mentioned, to perform the read-write operations. And how they provided, so when you say Hadoop shell commands, is the Hadoop command itself. This is a Hadoop command. So this we call as a CLI. CLI means command line interface. It's an interface, right? This is a command line interface. Now when I do like a Hadoop, okay, Hadoop FS. So Hadoop basically here, this Hadoop is a common interface. It is like a basically shell script. When I pass fs as an argument, when I say Hadoop fs, right, the request will go to the name node. That means we want to interact with the Hadoop file system, that is give Hadoop fs. So Hadoop fs we need to use. So use to interact with the HDFS. Right? So here basically what happens, right? Whenever you give this command, like Hadoop fs, okay, so the request goes to name node. So whatever you want to do on HDFS, you want to read a file, write a file, delete a file, delete a directory, or delete the files recursively, whatever you want to do. So you need to give this command called Hadoop fs, and the request will go to the name node, because the name node is a master of your HDFS. It will have all the metadata. Whenever you are changing something, your metadata will be affected. We need to update that metadata. So the name node will take care of updating that metadata. Right? So later versions of the Hadoop, okay, so we can use this command also, HDFS, FS also we can use. So both either Hadoop FS or HDFS FS also we can use. Right? So there are other options, like say Hadoop jar, right? If you want to run any MapReduce job, we need to use this command. Okay, use to run a Hadoop MapReduce job. MapReduce application or job. If you want to run a MapReduce application, we need to write some Java code that we'll see again little later, right? If you want to run a MapReduce job, okay, you want to use a command called as a Hadoop jar we have to use, right? Or you want to run some Hadoop admin commands. There's something Hadoop fs admin or a dfs admin. So dfs admin, some blah blah blah. So to perform admin tasks, we can use this, or we can say Hadoop version. This will give the version of the Hadoop like this. So to understand this, so even though the Hadoop is completely written in Java, the Hadoop HDFS is written in Java, MapReduce is written in Java, we don't need to bother about knowing the Java to interact with the HDFS. Right? What we can do, right? If you know this Hadoop FS command, it will be good enough. Right? So now what are these Hadoop FS commands? So if you want to know this Hadoop FS commands, just to show this one, Hadoop FS commands. This is going to the Apache documentation, or this one only, C file system shell guide, or you can take any one of them, 2.4 or 3.1, any one. Okay, so let me take 3.1 is the latest, or in a real time, like a most of the people who are working the 2.x version, you can take one of this, any one of these will be good enough. So let's go there. Okay, see, for you append to file, cat, ch group, ch mode, ch owner, copy from local, copy to local, count, okay, cp, du, dus, expunge, get facl, file access controls, get merge, ls, lsr, mkdir, move from local, move to local, move, put, rm, rmr, okay, set facl, set rep, stat, tail, test, text, touch. Okay, if you see, only these are the options we have with the Hadoop FS commands. You need to practice them also. If you look at them, you can remember them. If you want to list a file, okay, in a local file system, what we do, we use a ls command, but here we need to use a Hadoop FS hyphen ls or minus ls you need to do. Or I want to list the files recursively. Here we give Hadoop fs minus ls r we can view, or minus ls space minus r you can view. Or you want to create a directory, you can say Hadoop fs minus mkdir. Or you want to move a file from local system to the HDFS, you can say move from local. Or you want to move a file from the HDFS to the local system, so we use move to local. Or you want to move a file within the HDFS, we can use Hadoop fs hyphen mv. Or you want to put a file from the local system to the HDFS, Hadoop fs minus put local path and the HDFS path. Or you want to remove a file, you can use Hadoop fs minus rm. Or you want to remove all the files in a directory, Hadoop fs minus rmr, right? Or you want to copy the file within the HDFS, Hadoop fs minus ap. You want to count the number of files in a directory, you can use Hadoop fs hyphen count on the HDFS path. Similarly, copy to local, copy from local. Or you want to change any ownership or group, you can use this. Or you want to append to a file, you can use append to a file option. So these are like hardly, we can say here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. All hardly 32 commands will be there. And here they have given the complete details of this. Right? So the file system FS shell includes various shell like commands that directly interact with the Hadoop distributed file system, directly interact with the HDFS, as well as other file system that Hadoop supports, such as local fs, HFTP, fs or S3, another. Okay, so whenever we are configuring the Hadoop cluster, remember this point I didn't told earlier, this is because you may confuse. We can use not only HDFS, we can use AWS S3 as a file system, or we can use Azure data lake or Azure blob as a file system. Or even you can use local file system also as a file system of the Hadoop. So based on the configuration, we can mention that one. Okay. So now these are some commands they are giving. Say append to. So usage here they given HDFS, right? Like we can use either Hadoop or HDFS. DFS we can use. Okay. So if you're using this one, we use this HDFS, DFS or Hadoop FS. Okay, both will be same. Okay, don't worry. So we can use HDFS, DFS hyphen append to file, local file and the HDFS file. Or we can have multiple local files and one HDFS file. Okay, so we can mention like this cat. You want to see the content of a file, you want to display the content of the file, we can see HDFS DFS minus cat or Hadoop FS minus cat, and you can give the file name. Okay, but in a real time, don't try to cat the files unless you know the size of the file. If the size of the file is small, we can do a cat. If the size of the file is very big, don't perform a cat, because it will try to stream, it will try to read the entire file and display on your console, on your terminal. So it will keep on reading that data if the data is very huge file. So be mindful while using the cat command. And you want to change the group permissions, or you want to change the rewrite permissions, or you want to change the owner, we can use these things, change group, change mode, change owner, right? And again, copy from local. So this is a simple command. Here it's written. So HDFS, DFS, hyphen copy from local, local SRC, that means local path, and the HDFS path. Similarly, copy to local, count. This count will give the number of files. Okay. So there are again different options are there. We can do a file count, content size, file name, quota space, counts, all these things. The CP command. DU, this is the disk usage. So how much of what is the file size on the HDFS? You can use a DU command. DUS, like a disk uses summary. Okay, so expunge. So expunge is something like, right, whenever we remove a file from the HDFS, Hadoop FS minus RM or HDFS DFS RM, the file will not be completely removed. It will be moved to some temporary location. Like you remember, whenever you remove a file from your desktop, it will go to a recycling bin. In case you want to reclaim that from the recycling bin, you can restore the file. If you have accidentally moved a file, removed a file, so it will go to the recycling bin. So if later you realize that you want to get that file, you can restore it from the recycling bin. Okay, same way, when you remove a file in the HDFS, it will not be immediately removed. It will be put to a copy to some temp location. And again, there is some expunge cycle time interval will be there. Let's say every 1 hour or every 2 hour, whatever the content in the temp location, which are marked to be removed, after 2 hours, after 1 hour, it will remove that. Okay, but whenever I delete a file, immediately I want to delete it, I'm damn sure that this file has to be deleted. Then you can use this command called as a expunge command you can use. Do you remember something? We have something like a delete and a shift delete. If you use a shift delete, the file will not go to the recycling bin. It is a permanently deleted. If you just say delete, then the file will go to the recycling bin. And whenever you restart your system, at that time, the contents in the recycling bin will be erased. Okay, so this expunge is such a feature in the HDFS. And other commands, get, we can get the file locally, get AFCL, this is like a function access control list, like who has a read write operations, and get merge. You have like a multiple small files, you want to combine them into a single large file, you can use get merge. LS command, this is just to list the number of files, the contents in a HDFS path. LSR, recursively list the files. We can give ls minus r also, make directory, mkdir to create a directory, move from local, move to local, move, put all these things, right? So if you spend hardly some 10 to 15 minutes, right, you will be well versed with the HDFS. In real time also, we'll be doing the same commands. If you want to automate some process, so take these commands, put in a shell script, then you can like schedule that shell script to run if it is required. Okay, so this is how we'll be working with the Hadoop shell commands. The commands are very simple. If you already know Unix commands, you can easily connect to that. Say du, okay, cp, ls, mv, mkdir, rm, chown, chmod, chgroup. All these are similar to Unix Unix commands only. With the same options they are given for the HDFS also. So here I want to tell something to you, right? So when you look at the Unix file system, if you don't know all these things, don't bother, leave it. The Unix file system follows some standards called POSIX standards. Okay, POSIX standards. Even your Hadoop, okay, Hadoop DFS also, Hadoop distributed file system also, nothing but your HDFS, this also follows the POSIX standards. Okay, these are some certain standards. Like if you take any of the Unix system, right, there will be something called as a root directory. Okay, under this root directory, there will be another directories will be there. Yeah. So like this, another directories. But if you take this as a Windows, we have a C drive, D drive, E drive, something like that. So there are certain standards we need to follow when you're implementing a file system if you're going with a Unix operating system, right? So even the HDFS also follows the POSIX standards. So that's why some of the Hadoop shell commands are very much similar to the your Unix shell commands. Okay, so that's why in the beginning of the like a course I told, if you're aware of the Unix file system or a Unix shell commands, like as a prerequisite, you'll feel more comfortable with the Hadoop shell commands. Or even if you don't know about that, no worry, but just know we saw it. These commands are very simple, very easily, directly understandable. So we no need to go for a Java coding for this. We can simply, run these Hadoop shell commands. But how this Hadoop shell command is internally working, right? This Hadoop command is internally actually invoking a Java code behind the screens. It is invoking a Java code. Okay, so it's like your Hadoop script is a wrapper on top of that Java code, I can say. So whenever you run this command, right? So this Java client will connect to the name node. It will get the all the details and it will talk to the data nodes, like to read the data or to write the data, right? So like this programmatically also we can do that. Okay, but we no need to think of how we can do that programmatically. Okay, so because nowadays, like I mentioned, we are not using the MapReducer. We are not going to deal with HDFS programmatically, right? So, but still, it's good to know that this Hadoop provides a Java and C++ APIs, and the client retrieves metadata such as blocks location from the name node by using that APIs, HDFS APIs, and the client directly accesses the data nodes. Once it gets the blocks of information, the through Java code, it will directly talk to the data nodes to fetch that blocks of information. So Java APIs are most commonly used, covered in this course. It's not required, and it will be used by MapReducer also. So that we'll see later. Okay. So this is like a more about our HDFS. Okay. And here I need to talk something about this HDFS also, right? So whenever you are looking at this HDFS, so I'm using a path, right? Let's say this is my HDFS path, right? So if you want to copy a file, okay. So this is your HDFS path. So this is, I can say LFS, and this I can say as a HDFS. Distributed file system, right? So now we are just mentioning like this, but what happened, right? So this HDFS path is a like a normal HDFS path we are looking, but there is something called as a fully qualified HDFS path. Okay, that fully qualified HDFS path, we have to prefix the name node identity. Okay, let me put it, fully qualified HDFS path. When I say fully qualified HDFS path, it will be equal to name node identity plus, okay, the file path. Okay, so what do you mean by this name node identity? So like I mentioned, right, name node as a service, it will be running on some system. So if you prefix that to the file path on HDFS, that becomes a name node identity. Okay, so it becomes a something like how we can mention that, right? So we can call that as a URL. Okay, so URI, we can call that as, so that will be represented something like this. For example, it can go like this, HDFS:// hostname, where your name node is running, port, the port name number on which your name node service is listening, / okay, the file path. Let's say I'll take this as a file path. This is a file path on HDFS. Okay, then I can say this is a file path. It will be like this. That means if you take an example, okay, so whatever we have seen, my project, this one, right? So this one we can represent like this. HDFS:// let's say some IP number like quick.cloud, let's say this is a host name on which my name node is running, and let's say 500, okay, let's say 70 something, is the port number, right? So this is the host name and the port number where your name node service is running, and we are qualifying this as a HDFS colon. So this is called as a HDFS URI. So this we can call as, okay, HDFS, okay, URI, uniform resource identifier or something, right? URL and URI. So it is like an identifier. So this name node service provides us some web UI also. Okay, like we can, like you are within the network of where your Hadoop cluster is. Okay, then you can give this path something like this, like a HDF, like a quiz.cloudera:50070. Then you can access your HDFS from the browser also. I think like yesterday I have shown that. Okay, so now I cannot show that because I need to start that VM system. No, to start that VM system, it will take some 10 to 15 minutes. So next class, when I start that VM system, I can show that. So one way we can access that HDFS is through the Hadoop shell commands. This is most common way of using. Like another way is we can access through some web also. There is some web interface is also there. Interface to access HDFS. Okay, so there is a some particular. So I think we need to give this one. So if you go to the browser, so if you give this one, like HTTPS or HTTP, this one, so it will be, you will be connecting to this like a, we can access the HDFS from app. For web interface to access HDFS, we can give like this. And again here, this number can be some different, some port number. I can say some number. This number will be different than this number will be. This port number will be different. This port number will be different. Okay, so it will be like that. So using Java APIs programs, you can write and access HDFS, or simply using the Hadoop shell commands, we can access it. Or by using the web intervals also, we can access the HDFS. So in the more real time, will be like generally when you're connecting to Hadoop cluster, we'll be connecting the client node, right? From the client node, we can use this Hadoop shell commands. Now you have a desktop and your desktop is connected to the network where your Hadoop cluster is also there. Then you know the name node identity, the host name and the port number where to access the web interface or the HDFS. This we can give in the browser, then we can access your HDFS from there also. So these are the different ways of accessing your HDFS. Or we can use Ambari, or if you're using a Cloudera, there is something like a Cloudera manager, and the Cloudera manager has a something called as a file browser, browse file system. From there also you can access. Okay, so here I just want to add, I'm using some term called Cloudera, right? And sometimes I'm using something like a HortonWorks or sometimes like a Mapper. So what are these? Okay. So these are the commercial distributions of when I say Hadoop, it is a Apache Hadoop. Okay. So which is like a, this is an open source Hadoop. Now these are the commercial distributions of the Hadoop. These people, these are some set of people who created their own companies. They have taken this plain vanilla Apache Hadoop. On top of that, they made some customizations or their integrated so many other products, and they started shipping, they started selling the Hadoop. So that become the commercial distributions of the Hadoop. So if you go to the real time, many people are using one of these distributions like Cloudera or HortonWorks or a Mapper. Okay, so all these things will have the same features of the Hadoop only. When you say Hadoop shell commands or MapReduce course, whatever it is. Okay, the difference is if as an organization, if I'm in a production, I got some production issue, right? I don't have the expertise team to fix that one. So what I do, I'll go to these people and I will ask them. So there will be some SLA, service level agreements, where they will come up and fix the solution. If I go with Apache Hadoop, which is open source Hadoop, if I got some production issue, so there will no dedicated team to help me. I need to realize on the documentation, or I need to go through the code and understand and fix it, or I need to go through the forums, open community forums, I need to go. So which will take a time and which is not a reliable, we may not get a reliable solution. But here we can get a committed solution from the dedicated people. So that's why we'll pay the support license supporting cost to the license amount will pay to the Clouder or Hortonworks or Mapper. So you can say most of them people who initially adopted Hadoop, we can say most of the people are using Clouder, which are on on-premise clusters. Right, later on some people move to Hortonworks, some people move to Mapper. Now I can say Mapper is very less. Okay, now there are cloud commercial distributions, there are cloud distributions of Hadoop also. There are cloud distributions of Hadoop. These are commercial distributions of Hadoop. There are cloud distributions of Hadoop also. So this is where we may be using a term called as EMR, or we may use in something like HD Insights, or we may be using called as a data proc. Okay, all these are nothing but this particular cloud vendor managed versions of the Hadoop. So if you take EMR, this is like a AWS managed Hadoop cluster. So this is a AWS managed Hadoop cluster, because they will manage it. We don't need to merge it. In fact, HDFS, this is like a Microsoft Azure managed Hadoop cluster. And they also taken this plain Apache Hadoop only. On top of that, they made their own services, right? And the data proc is a Google managed Hadoop cluster. So now in general, for the, say, for you take the EMR, right? So for the EMR, we can use a HDFS as a file system, or you can use AWS S3 also as a file system. So like we have a HDFS, which is like a distributed file system. This AWS also provides a file system called S3. It's an Amazon Simple Storage Service. Right. Similarly, for HD Insights, we can use either HDFS or a data lake. Or similarly, for data proc also, we can use HDFS, or we can use like a Google file system as a file system of the Hadoop. Okay, so what are the things we are using, right? So once you have either a Cloudera Hadoop cluster, or a Hortonworks Hadoop cluster, or Mapper Hadoop cluster, or EMR, or HDFS data proc Hadoop cluster, these Hadoop FS commands or HDFS DFS commands, right? So they will work. Sometimes the notations can change. So got it. So this is how the Hadoop HDFS we can interact with. Is it clear? Any doubts so far? Are we good so far?
Yeah, I think so, Hari. It's good.
Okay. So like once the registrations are closed, right? Once you got the access and all, I will share this VM machine and all. You can download config and you can practice also. So maybe like I will show the practice in another couple of classes. Okay, so just we'll take another 5 minutes to like a complete like a the some other details of this HDFS. So like I mentioned right last time, we can configure the Hadoop in a different modes, like a distributed mode, pseudo distributed mode, and a local mode, right? So in a pseudo distributed mode, what happens, right? Whatever the services I mentioned, like name node, secondary name node, data node, resource may, all these will be running on a single system. So that is a pseudo distributed mode. Pseudo means it's like a dupe, it's like not original. The fully distributed mode is a original distributed mode where these services like name node, secondary name node, data nodes, they will be running on a different nodes in the cluster. Okay. Now the for if you want to install and all, I think already we covered this. We need a Java SSH, all these things. In Windows also we can install this Hadoop and all. So three options we have to install the Hadoop: local mode or standalone mode, pseudo distributed mode, and fully distributed mode. This we already discussed, right? So here, okay. Now I want to tell this one, yeah. So when I'm running a command like this, right? So Hadoop FS minus copy from local and the local location and HDFS location, it is working, right? But here I'm not mentioning the name node identity, but still how it is working means, okay. So whenever you're running this command, like I mentioned, right, a client, a Java client code will be invoked, and the Java client code will be reading some of these Hadoop properties. So where these Hadoop properties are there, so this is very important, guys. Everyone please pay some attention. We have Hadoop configuration files like core-site.xml, hdfs-site.xml, and mapreduce-site.xml, and yarn-site.xml, and hadoop-env.sh. So we have the Hadoop configurations available in these XML files. There are some default values will be there, and some of the values we can change also. And whenever we are interacting with HDFS or MapReduce in end, whatever the Java, whatever the client that is interacting with the Hadoop, first they will go and read these configuration files. By reading these configuration files, they will get to know the your Hadoop configuration details, like what is my name node identity, what is the replication factor, HDFS replication factor that is set, okay, what is HDFS block size, where is my resource manager running, okay. So other some, there are many more details. There are hundreds to thousands of settings will be there, but we no need to remember by heart all those things. So like we are just good to know, like these configurations will be there in this site.xml files. Okay, so there will be a Hadoop conf directory we need to set to the location where these site.xml files will be there. So in general, if you take a Cloudera or Hortonworks and all, it will be there in /etc/hadoop/conf. Okay. In this location, so we have these things, core-site.xml. So some properties that are available, that are required as a global parameters that are applicable to the entire cluster, okay, those details will be available in the core-site.xml. Let's say for entire Hadoop cluster, there will be one name node. So that name node details will be there in the core-site.xml. Right, then you have something like hdfs-site.xml. So the properties that are required, configuration properties for the HDFS, they will be there in the hdfs-site.xml. Similarly, you have something like a mapreduce-site.xml. So when you work with the mapreduce, some properties will be there. Similarly, you have something like a yarn-site.xml. Okay, so like when you want to configure, say, yarn related configurations, okay. So let's say, for example, I can say we can have name node identity details, say example. So this is an example, right? Example. I will show you all these things practically, don't worry. For now, we just note on this, right? So there's like a DFS default. Default name or something. So this will be set to this one. So we'll have some setting like this: HDFS :// host name where the name node is running and the port number where that it is listening, right? In HDFS.set.xml, right? So we can have something like a DFS.replication. So let's say this is a 3, right? And it's like a fs dot block size. Okay, so which will be sent to some xs number, some x number of bytes. Okay, then map reduce hyphen side dot xml. So let's say in this one, okay, we can have something like a resource manager entity. Okay, I think like a job tracker is equal to some host name where the job tracker process running and the port number in which port that is running, this kind of a details, and the yarn hyphen side dot xml, and similarly some yarn related configurations will be there. Okay, so there will be some default configurations or specific configurations that will be available in the site.xml files. So whenever we set up a Hadoop cluster, right? So this thing we need to set as environment, Hadoop conf directory should point to this location, and within this location these files will be there. Okay, so the location for the configuration files is specified via Hadoop conf dir environment property, right? And these will be in under this directory we have these site.xml files, right? So this is about the configuration details of HDFS. So for example, okay, this is the name. Long term, right? Okay. So property name fs.default.name value HDFS:// localhost. Let's say if my system is if my name node running in the local system :8020. This is a port number on which your name node process is running. Then you can have some description, name node URI, and the description is entered and the property is entered. Is there an XML file? Right? You have like a tags like this. So in our code .xml we can have one of the property like this, the configurations for the core of the Hadoop. For example, io properties, name node properties will be there in the core fnsite.xml. okay, similarly we have like a hdfs-site.xml. So in this hdfs-site.xml we have configuration for the name node, data nodes, and secondary name node daemons. So because for hdfs to work, these three daemons are required, right? And these three daemons require some details, so those details will be there. So dfs.namenode.name.directory. So your name node will be maintaining some metadata, right? The fs images where it has to store, and the system where it is running on top of this is on the system in this path. Okay, it will store the fs image locations, the path on the local file system where the name node store the namespace and the transaction logs persistently. So edit log, fs images, those things will be put into this location. And dfs.datanode.data.dir, so This is a comma separate list of paths on the local file system of the data node where it should store the blocks. So like I told, right, each data node will be contributing a certain portion of the hard disk to the HDFS. So when you're writing a block, it is storing those blocks on that portion of the hard disk, on the local hard disk, right? And where that hard disk, so when you say hard disk, it has some path. So this is a path where you can, each data node will store the blocks on each of its data node. So like this, we can have a configuration details there. Okay.
Hari, when it comes to cloud, where do we usually store this persistent data?
So all this will be there, right? Say your cloud also is nothing but a, it's like a group of systems only. There is also one cluster. So that cloud people, cloud service vendors will provide these details. Okay. There also same location slash etc hadoop slash conf. You can find that one. Okay. So the difference between these distributions and cloud services, right? See, again, I think in the beginning only, when you want to create an Hadoop cluster, there are two ways. One is the on-premise cluster where you set up your, where you acquire the hardware, where you install the software, networking, installing the Hadoop, configuring, and everything you will maintain with the help of your Hadoop admins or something. Or you can go for the cloud. So when you go for the cloud, what you can say, we should, once you have a cloud account, okay, you want to have a one, let's say EMR cluster. Then, 1 minute, guys. Sorry. So when you go to the cloud environment, right? So we no need to care bother about the infrastructure. This cloud people will provide one UI where you mention, I want these many nodes. This should be the configuration of the my name node. This should be the configuration of my data nodes. Okay, these are the details of which I want. This is RAM I want. This is hard space I want. If you choose, right, they only will create a cluster, set up a cluster, and give to you within 15 to 20 minutes of time. And again, what are the properties I told? Right, the same properties will be there on those systems only. Like say, they have given a one cluster, right, with a group of systems. In one of the systems, there also the master node will be there, where the name node will be running. In that name node system, there also will be location called slash etc slash hadoop conf directory. Within that conf directory, the core-side.xml, sdf-side.xml, mapreader-side.xml will be there. You're understanding?
I understood this one. I was asking about, in the last slide you showed about storing the persistent data in your local system, you know, local file system, right?
Let's take this as a one data node.
I understood this architecture, Ari. I was asking just about the persistent data where you will be storing. Can you just open? Okay.
No, that's what I'm telling. Right now, I cannot show. Next class, I will show because already we are almost running out of the time. When you open the VM image, I can show you that. Okay, for now, we'll tell. Now, let's consider this is like a one data node and consider this is the entire hard disk of a one data node, right? In this entire hard disk of this data node, let's say we are creating a separate directory called, okay, slash home slash Hadoop slash training. Okay, not this one. So within this this core, right, I need to go to HDFS.
Yeah, I was asking about that one.
One I'm coming there. I missed that configuration. This is a checkpoint. So like we have created dfs.datanode.datadirectory, which is pointing to /home/hadoop/training/hadoop_work/data/data. This we can give any path, right? End of the day, this directory will be there in the hard disk. And whenever we are storing the blocks of data, those blocks of data will be stored under this directory. Okay, you are getting this?
Yeah. Okay. When you say local file system, it's the node local system, right?
Yeah. So when I say a local file system, right? So generally, this is we use for you to differentiate that. See, whatever the hard disk that a data node has, that entire hard disk, that operating system of the data node can access. Okay. But a portion of the hard disk, it is contributing to the HDFS. So how I can tell a portion of the hard disk is contributing to HDFS? Okay, so let me tell you like this. So within my hard disk, let's say I have like a directory DIR1, DIR2, DIR3, and DIR4. Okay, so now let's say this DIR4 is the location where I will store the Hadoop file blocks. But if you see, all these DIR1, DIR2 are in the LFS only. That means it's a locally accessible the file system. So when a particular say LFS, okay, so if my file is there on any one of these directory DIR1, 2, 3, I'm generally referring that as an LFS, and the DIR4 and the multiple systems which are contributed to the HDFS, that I'm calling it as HDFS.
Got it.
HDFS is sitting on top of the all the hard disks. Sitting on the top of the hard disk, it is sitting on the local file systems of the all the hard disk like that.
Okay. That's where I got confused. Thank you.
Yeah. No problem. So generally people will get convinced. So we have created one dedicated directory on each of the data node where we are storing the HDFS blocks. In this directory, we don't store any other files. And at least we don't give access to the general users to write to this directory also. So there will be one separate Hadoop user account will be there. Only that Hadoop account only will have a read write access to this directory like that. Okay. So like this, we'll be having a configuration files where it will determine where the blocks will be stored on the data nodes, where the edit logs or FSP image will be stored, what is the memory that a name node can use, what is the memory that MapReduce can use, right? And other details like where the secondary name node can create the checkpoint, how much time what checkpoint interval it can take, right? All this information we can find this HDFS site.section. And replication factor, I told you, it is like a DFS dot replication. In a pseudo distributed mode, we'll set the value as a 1. In a real time, it will be by default, it will be 3, like that. Okay. So this is how we'll be we can get the Hadoop configuration files. Again, all these things some of the admin related stuff, we don't need to go there. But admin, whenever he want to start in Hadoop cluster, right? So he will set up he will install all the software, start the services. And before starting the services, he do like a DFS space name node --- format. So when I run this command, what will happen, right? It will read the configuration files. And let's say the DIR3, we are using to store the name node files. So name node related files, the metadata files we are going to put on a directory 3, right? So what this command will do, right? HDFS name node --format, this will go to the directory where that name node service is running. It will change the access permissions to only one Hadoop user account only. Okay, and it will not give, we don't give access control to any other user. Okay, so this will format it. Then we can say start-dfs.sh. So this will be the shell command that Hadoop administrator can run. When you run this command, this will start the name node. This will start the secondary name node. This will start the data node process. Okay, and again in a real time, how we know what are the manager nodes and what are the worker nodes, right? So for this, under this configuration files only, /etc/hadoop/configure files only, we have something called as a slaves, and we have something called as a master. Okay, so in this master file, this just a file name, simple master file name itself, it's like a file. Okay, in this master file we'll mention the name node details, name node details like a IP name, IP or host name. Okay, we can mention the secondary name node details. The name node details again, IP or host name. In the slaves, this is also like a simple file with no extension. Okay, in this file we'll mention the list of worker nodes. So here we'll mention the list of their IPs, okay, or host names we'll mention. Now, as administrator, what you'll do, right? The administrator will not connect to each and every system to start the data node services. Let's say he connected to the master node. Okay, from there he will give a command like, okay, start-bfs.sh. So there will be a shell script. This is provided by the Hadoop itself. When you install the Hadoop, you can get this command. When you run this command, right, again a Java client program will be started. It will go to the master file and see where is this IP number. It will connect to this IP number, and on this IP number it will start the name node process. And it will see where is the secondary name node is configured by reading these files, and it will connect to that IP number. On the system, the secondary name node service will be started. Now it will read the slaves file. It will get the list of IPs, and it will connect to that each IP, and on each IP, like, it will send a remote invocation command, because each system in the cluster is interconnected with each other. Each system can talk to another system. So from wherever you are running this shell script, that host will connect to this IP number, and it will start a data node service on that system. So this is how it the configurations are mentioned for the Hadoop. So in the /etc/hadoop-conf, we have some site.xml files, and we have a master and slave files. So from there, the framework will understand the IP numbers or the host numbers, where supposed to start a name node service, secondary name node service, and a data node services like that. And there is another one called like a start-yarn.sh or start-mapreduce.sh. Okay, yarn.sh. When you run this command, right, or what it will do, it will start the resource manager. Again, here in the mapreduce-site.xml, we have mentioned there is a job tracker. And job tracker is nothing but your resource manager. It will connect to that host name, and it will start that resource manager on this system. And this one will read the slaves file. From that, it will get the list of worker nodes. On the same worker nodes, it will go on to start the node manager services. That means your task tracker services, it will be started. So this is how your Hadoop configuration files and the scripts are set up to start these services. Okay, so this will be the Hadoop admin activities. We no need to bother about them. In our VM player, what we are doing, right? Whenever we run our VM player, these scripts will be automatically run on this startup only. So that's why you are not that's why you are not explicitly running these shell scripts. But I can show you, I can stop the services and again start the services using the shell scripts. Maybe like in another practical, whenever you have the practice sessions, right? At that time, I can show you. Okay. So that's all about all these things, guys, for today. Okay. Sorry, like I have taken more time today. Like next time onwards, I'll try to keep a watch. Like I try to keep him. Okay, I will watch my time. Okay. Any doubts so far? Are we good today? Any doubts?
Yes, we are good.
Okay, we are good. Okay, then we'll wind up. So just to confirm your registration about this.